Welcome to this week's Catching Up With, presented by Dunlop. I'm here with Tony Alessi, team manager of the Smartop Bullfrog Spas Motoconcepts Honda team. Tony, you and I have been friends a very, very long time.
Yes, since we were teenagers.
I can remember literally the phone call. I'm at my desk at Cycle News. You call me and you say, I'm going to buy this used PW for the boys, but I don't know if I want to go down that road. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I actually do remember that. I was an announcer at the time at Paris Raceway.
Yeah.
And the kids had been, you know, 3 years old, 4 years old. And they were coming to the track. They'd sit in the announcing tower, play with their little dirt bikes and make little dirt bike tracks. And I was thinking, man, I don't know about this. Should I? I mean, it's we're here. We're at a track. They're boys. Should we go down this road?
Yeah.
And it was like, all right, well, I'm here anyway. I got a job to do, and you know what? I'm going to let my wife handle it.
Yeah.
And that's how that went. I was like, you know what? You can take them down to the peewee track and just let them go ride down there.
Uh-huh.
And I honestly, their little peewee races that they had down there, people would come over and go, hey, your kid's ripping. I'm like, really? I never went to any of those little peewee races that they had down there.
Uh-huh.
I mean, yeah, I mean, I took them riding during the week. We rode behind the apartment building that we lived at. It was Mike and Jeff and Cole Seeley. We'd all have little peewee moto sessions going on right behind our apartment building. It was pretty cool. And we did that every day. And, you know, and then I'd go to the race on the weekend and I would announce and do cycle news stories.
Yeah.
And my wife, or the boy's mom, would be down there and she would basically run the whole thing. So that's how that went.
How long was it just a casual fun thing before you turned competitive mini dad?
I mean, I think that we started to go to all those big races, you know, pretty much within a year or two of them riding.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I don't know what you would call serious, but man, I remember sleeping in my truck and, you know, trying to drive, you know, can I get 800 miles done today? It was crazy stuff, you know? And so I don't know if that is like considered serious or not, but or if that's still in the fun category. But I would say when the boys were probably about 12 and 13, it was pretty evident that they had the ability to be pro riders.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay, wait. So what year was the peewee, the first bike?
93.
93.
Yeah.
Okay. 93. I'm in a motorhome in Springfield, Illinois, with Ricky Graham. I know it was 93 because it was the year he won the title. I remember you calling me and saying, Donnie, do you have any like crazy Japanese remedies or some things that will make a bone heal faster? And I'm all, well, why? And you're like, well, Michael broke his arm or leg or something. And we've got a regional in 2 weeks.
Okay, so that year.
So right away.
I know that story. And just so you know, that story was actually in 95.
No. No, it was 93 because I remember being with Ricky and I was like, because Ricky at the time was drinking like
I remember the story. So I don't remember, maybe I have the year wrong, but okay. The story went kind of like this. Yeah, he broke his tibia fibia, but at the bottom, uh-huh. Right? And this was like 2 weeks before the regional. Mm-hmm. And we're like, what are we going to do here? And so we ended up having him race, which again, craziness. And I told him, he's in a cast.
Yeah.
So his leg is out, right? And he's sitting on the bike. I said, just go out there. All you have to get is, I think it was maybe fifth place or sixth place, and you're in. And he took off and won the race.
With a cast.
With a cast on. And never stood up one time. He sat down the entire time.
Nice.
So yeah, that craziness happened. I'm sure there's other. I'm sure that's commonplace for the most part nowadays. Parents are really, they're on it nowadays.
Yeah. Okay. Looking back at your career as racer dad, you know, because Mikey's he's in his 30s now. He's winding it down. What was the pinnacle of it? The like craziest time, the most pull your hair out time of Mikey's career for you being his dad?
Well, anytime that you're racing for a championship, you know what I'm saying? It's stressful, you know what I'm saying? Because there's only going to be one guy that wins. And so it's do or die. It's, you know, you're all in. It's, you know, win at all cost. You know what I'm saying? Because that's it. You're a contender for the championship. So any of those years could be linked to that. It would be 05 against Tedesco. Mm-hmm. It would be 06 against Villopoto. It'd be 07 against Langston and 012 against Dungy. Mm-hmm. All four of those years, Mike was second in the championship and, you know, raced to the last moto of the last race to get it. Unfortunately, it never went his direction, you know? But four times in AMA motocross, he was a contender to win the whole thing. Mm-hmm. And then obviously, in 2009 would have been his year because he came out and won the first three races of the year. Mm-hmm. And by the end of the third race, he had a 55-point already lead over Chad Reed, mm-hmm. who was our teammate. And he beat Chad Reed at that last race by 40-plus seconds. Mm-hmm. So it's like, we got this. All we got to do is just start riding, you know, 20% below our level and we can win this championship. But he ended up getting hurt.
That was the fence post that.
Yeah, we did a press program at High Point.
Yeah.
And the track wasn't quite finished. And there was a jump. And then when he landed, the berm wasn't quite built. So he went over the berm. On the other side of the berm was a massive grass downhill that was wet.
Oh.
And so he put the brake on, but the bike didn't stop. It was like being on ice. And he ran into a fence post at the bottom of the hill.
Mm-hmm.
Never crashed, never anything. His knee just hit the fence post just right and shattered his knee.
Kneecap. Yeah, yeah.
And so, if anything, that was probably the worst, you know? Because we knew we could be the champion that year. That was gonna be our year.
Yeah. So, looking back at, you know, everything from that first phone call that you and I had, right? Your life, not just the kids' lives, but changed dramatically, you know, like everything changed. You quit your other job that you had when I first was buddies with you. You moved up to the high desert and it was all in for the Alessi family.
Yeah, my coworkers and even my boss to some degree, I used to work at Waste Management. I was working there 17 or 18 years. My boss was Mike Smith. His son was a good rider, a top rider, and so we had a good relationship in terms of like dirt bikes and racing. And I had a really good job where I would go in early in the morning, like 3:30 in the morning. I'd get off at 3 in the afternoon and I had time to work with the guys. But it came to a point where it was very difficult to go riding where we lived. We lived in the Simi Valley, Moore Park area. And the problem with that is that all of our tracks were all up in the hills.
Yeah.
That was the norm. That's what Johnny O'Mara did and Don Hansen and David Bailey. They had all those tracks up in the Simi Valley Hills. And so we would just go ride those tracks every day and that was our practice and our training.
Mm-hmm.
But it came a time where all of a sudden it became increasingly difficult to go ride in the hills because the police would come.
Yeah.
And so at one point I had my wife out on the street with a walkie-talkie letting me know if she saw the cops coming to get out of there. You know, and then we got away so many times that they finally flew a helicopter in and then they confiscated all the bikes and that was it for me. When that happened, I was like, you know what? I'm not gonna be a lawbreaker to go take my kids riding dirt bikes. It shouldn't have to be this way, you know? I shouldn't have to feel like we're gonna get in trouble every time we go riding.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, that's it. I'm gonna move these guys to the middle of the desert where there's nobody around, build our tracks and train and practice. And to be able to do that means I gotta sell my house, which I had paid out for. It was a paid off house.
Mm-hmm.
I have to quit my job. I had to cash in my 401k and take that amount of money, take it up there and say, hey, you got 3 years to turn this into a pro ride. Yeah. Otherwise, I have to go back to work and this dream is over, you know?
Yeah.
So that was pretty, all in and obviously a lot of stress.
Yeah. It all worked out though.
Yes, it did. It worked out. Mike was a pro rider at age 16 And he had a really good contract right out of the box, so he was good. And then Jeff got a pro contract the year later, and when he turned 16. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we were on our way at that point. Mm-hmm.
Looking back, what was the brightest moment for you?
Well, I don't know if there's a bright moment or a dark moment, but my favorite moment would obviously be in 2004, when you know, Mike was a 16-year-old kid, and you know, we said, you know, essentially, look, we're gonna go try to make a debut out here at 16 years old. Honda wanted us to ride a 250. The bike really was more of a Nathan Ramsey bike at that time. Mm-hmm. It really wasn't really set up for Mike.
Mm-hmm.
So I asked that to be postponed until the fall and just let us ride the 450, which obviously he had a really good lead up to the first race, because he had just won a big race against Ryan Hughes at the Four Stroke National, mm-hmm. which was big because Ryan was in his prime.
Yeah.
And then a couple weeks after that, we went to a race in Salinas, the Salinas Supercross, and Mike beat McGrath. And then we moved the whole program to Millville to prepare for that first race.
Yeah.
So all of that was all on a 450.
Yeah.
He went to Loretta Lynn's and swept both of the 450 classes there. So we were good on the 450 already.
Mm-hmm.
And so I asked Honda, look, I think it's just gonna be better to let him ride the 450 here, but I really like that shock you guys have, and I like those foot pegs. Could we possibly just move those over to the 450? And they wouldn't support that. They were like, no, if you're on 250 program, we'll support. If you're on a 450 program, you're on your own.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, we'll do it on our own. So we had a Honda 450 four stroke, and obviously it took us two races, but by the second race Mike ended up third overall, which was enormous, right? So we're 16-year-old kid, Carmichael to the left, Wyndham to the right, and actually led Wyndham for 75 or 80% of the last moto.
Yeah. It
could have almost been a second overall. Yeah, so he ended up third overall, and to the best of my knowledge, I don't think a 16-year-old has ever been on the podium in the premier class, 450 for motocross.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe that's ever happened.
Yeah.
So I think that's a first, and so that would have been if there's a highlight, that would have been it.
Okay. On the flip side, if there's one incident or decision you could take back or change, what would that be?
I mean, that's pretty obvious, right? In 2013, we were having a pretty good season, and the race was rolling into Washougal, and so obviously that's on the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
And Jeff Alessi, my other son, hadn't been racing at that time, so he was just kind of, I guess, doing stupid stuff. And so I was like, I was trying to figure out a way, oh, come on, I'll just get you involved, you know, come out, you know, and you can help set up, you can do whatever. And so we actually went to a race on Thursday night at PIR, mm-hmm. which was a good race. And I noticed that Jeff was messing around with a laser pointer. He was like pointing it at stuff and whatever. And I was just like, I didn't think much about it. It's just like, that's Jeff and his dumb stuff that he does,
yeah.
right? And so then we went to the race, and not to any knowledge of myself or Mike, Jeff was out there fucking, I mean, messing around out in the woods. He was pointing the laser pointer, and he pointed in a couple of guys' eyes. I think one was actually Malcolm.
Uh-huh.
And then I think he pointed it at Villopoto. And so he got in all this trouble. I mean, I got a call on the radio. Hey, Davey Coombs has got your kid in a headlock. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's in fourth place right now.
Yeah.
No, Jeff, he's in trouble. Like, oh, where? Behind the starting gate. So I run over there, and I'm like, oh my God, what is going on here? And then I find out, you know, that this went down. And then one thing led to another, and we all got in trouble, even though it was just Jeff being Jeff.
Yeah.
Anybody who knows Jeff knows that that's kind of stupid stuff that the guy does. He's always doing something like that. And Mike got a huge fine, the biggest fine in, I think, AMA motocross history, because they link it together, right? Because he was helping us, right? He helped set up and do all that. If a crew member violates a rule, the rider can be penalized for what the crew member did.
Yeah.
So in this case, now Mike is liable for this offense.
Mm-hmm.
So now Mike gets a huge fine, and they take his points away, which he was in third or second, like that, in points, and it bumped him all the way back to seventh, so essentially destroyed his season right there. My boss was angry with the whole thing, so was I, probably more so, and then we all got in trouble too, mm-hmm. you know? So it ended up being just a huge mess. So that had to be by far the most stressful thing. I mean, if there's a stress rev limiter, I blew it up during that time. The limiter went past the final number.
Yeah.
That was just about more than I could handle, that whole thing, because realistically, we were just innocent people trying to go racing,
mm-hmm.
and we have a kid, Jeff, that wanted to clown around, and he got us in enormous amounts of trouble and got us fines and ultimately cost us a shot at that championship that year. So it was tough.
Okay, changing subjects. These days, you're the team manager here at Motoconcepts, and everyone that I ever speak to about it, they're like, man, Tony's a kick-ass manager.
Yeah.
I mean, was it an easy transition into your role here?
Well,
or was there like another learning curve going from dad manager to team manager?
Yeah, I mean, if you can manage a guy like Mike Alessi, he's tough. You know what I'm saying? It's like a lot of work. It's a lot of work on every front. So it definitely can condition you to be a really good manager, because you're catching or dodging or hitting a lot of balls all the time. Oh. And coming into pro race team manager role, I mean, I've got three pro riders with, same kind of whatever you want to call it, needs and requirements, maybe less drama. And to me, I found it extremely easy and enjoyable to do, mm-hmm. because it's what I have been doing my whole life anyway.
Yeah.
Just I had no drama involved or emotion attached to it. You know what I'm saying? The emotion part when you're dealing with a family member is way different than dealing with an athlete that's not your blood, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
You can still do the job. You can follow it A, B, C, D, but you're not gonna like get super emotional about it. And you just kind of lay it out like, okay, this is what you need. This is what we're gonna do.
Mm-hmm.
This is what's done,
yeah.
you know? And they appreciate that, because the riders are actually not used to getting that kind of level of treatment or service.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know why, but for me, it was natural to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And they all like it.
Okay, you've got three guys, Friese, who I, like anyone else, I had my preconceived notions about him from things you've seen, but having been around him, the guy is so cool and such a hard worker. Then you got Malcolm, who's a natural talent and a natural clown and always having fun. And then Justin Hill, who's got all this potential and raw speed, just needs to kind of be directed in the right way. How do you manage the three of them at the same time, but differently?
Yeah, so there are three different riders, three different agendas going on. It's the goal to try to incorporate agendas together so that they can work together.
Mm-hmm.
So we've been really good at that. I mean, Malcolm obviously is an incredible rider in the whoops. So he can bring out the best in Vince in that light.
Mm-hmm.
Vince is unstoppable in flat corners.
Mm-hmm.
So in that essence, he can bring out the best in Malcolm in those areas. And he has.
Mm-hmm.
If you notice, Malcolm is better on flat corners than he's ever been. And Vince is also better in the whoops this year than he's ever been.
Mm-hmm.
So
you got to get Vince to help Malcolm with his starts.
Well, true. That's the next topic that we're working on for sure. And I think that we've improved that a little bit from one race one to race two. Started 19th in the first race. Started 9th in the second race.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously, we had been telling Malcolm preseason that setup's working that we did with Vince's bike.
Mm-hmm.
And Vince, we told him, hey, look, we think Vince is going to hole shot or be right up front in these main events. Malcolm chose a different setting.
Mm-hmm.
After the first round, I talked to Malcolm some more. I said, look, remember we talked about that setting? I think we better go back to that setting.
Mm-hmm.
So we went back to that setting, and his starts were improved, and I think we're on the right track now with mm-hmm. him there. In terms of Justin Hill, I mean, at any moment, the guy could just be the guy that wins the race. Mm-hmm. I mean, on any given day at our test track, he is not just a little bit, but a lot faster than everybody else. Mm-hmm. And that's not just our team. That's Geico. That's everybody. He'll put down a lap time and just go, where did he cut the track? How'd that happen?
Yeah.
But he knows that he has to work on his game a little bit. We've worked on it. We worked on the short game a little bit and got that improved, but we lost a little bit at the end game. So now we're working more in the end game. So it's a work in progress. But, I mean, he's got ultra good talent. He's perfectly enjoyable to be around. He's really smart. Keep working.
Yeah. I guess last question. The team is privately owned by Mike Genova. There's some advantages to that, I think, because you can move faster, but then there's got to be some disadvantages also.
I believe it's all, obviously the disadvantages is it costs money,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
That's obviously the hard part. And to get funding for what costs us to do business is always a huge challenge, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because to run a race team at a caliber that can compete in the top 10 of 450 pro racing, you're gonna spend a lot of money on your program.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously, that's the downside, because we need to have more sponsorship money or some assistance from the promoter or Feld to help us run our program.
Mm-hmm.
It's always like the storyline that everybody lives by. Well, you got the platform right here. You should be able to capitalize and go get sponsors. Mm-hmm. The problem is, the sponsors don't really come to the teams. They go to the promoter and they want, their program inside the stadium more than they want it on the truck or the rider.
Yeah.
So it really, that model doesn't work for us. So it's difficult. And obviously the plus side of being a self-owned team is that we have the ability to make any change that we want,
mm-hmm,
on the bike, on the program, with the riders. I mean, we don't have to wait for approval from above. And we're not bound to a certain part on the bike. You know, you have to run X, Y, Z. We have more freedom. And I think that makes a difference, because you can tailor fit the bike better to the riders, mm-hmm, when you know that you're not bound by restrictions.
Yeah. Okay, I lied. I got one more question.
All right, one more question.
Tell me about the legend of the Tony Alessi ass dyno.
Ass dyno. Okay. All right. Human dyno. All right, so Terry Varner, which his shop at the time was in Upland next to Hinson. So we would get, I don't know if I can say this or not, I guess I can, it's been a long time now. But in our amateur years, we would get 40 85s delivered at one time.
Uh-huh.
And so what I would do is, when I got all the bikes, I would take them over to Varner and we put them all on the dyno. And the reason that we did that was to segregate
the good ones
from the bad ones. So obviously the best ones became the stock bikes.
Yeah.
And so those got pulled aside. And then the next ones after that would become the mod bikes, the super minis after that, and then practice bikes after that. And there was quite a variance, right? There were some 85s that had 16 and 17 horsepower, and there were some that had 22. Obviously 22 horsepower is like almost a good mod engine.
Yeah.
So we would put those aside for stock class Loretta Lynn, World Mini, Ponca City. And I mean, I can't even tell you how many times those bikes got tore down at those races because they were fast.
Yeah.
But rightfully so. We knew they were fast.
Yeah.
Anyway, the human dyno part comes in is that after we ran them on the dyno, I would go run them down the street just to confirm what they were and then make a note, whether they were strong bottom, strong mid, whatever, had good over rev.
Yeah.
So we would tag each one of those with what horsepower they made and comments about the power band.
Uh-huh.
And then those bikes would be put in position for its individual amateur national ahead of time.
But I've heard from, I can't remember which team rider it was, it might have been Vince, but like up at the shop in, the high desert, you just jump on a race bike in your street clothes, the helmet, brah, across the desert and come back with some feedback.
Oh yeah. No, that's normal, So, I mean, obviously, anytime we have a new engine that goes in a bike or, or an engine comes apart and gets rebuilt, I go ride them just to make sure that it's still there, right?
Yeah.
So, because if it's not there, it could be maybe one thing off or whatever. I mean, if bike's 2 horsepower down, that makes a difference. Mm-hmm. It's hard to get, you don't want to lose that 2 horsepower. So I just kind of verify them. I know what the power feels like. So I know I have a good reference point. So yeah. I just kind of check it off. I'll come back and say, yeah, this one's good.
Yeah. Nice. Hey, dude, it's always great to catch up with you, buddy.
All right. Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.